Ooh, the shoes you came on, feel the earth you made from. Good evening. It is 6 o'clock, and that means it is now time for God Wants You Back. I'm Pastor Bill.
And I am Rose.
And we are here in the studio tonight to bring a message to you. And we're going to begin with some words, some worship in song from Rose. This is Through It All.
Hallelujah, hallelujah,
it really is a blessing to have her here, and I know I can feel the Spirit of God in her music from the very beginning. While she was still in Vietnam and I was still here, when she would send me the different sound bites and different recordings of her songs, I could sense that, I could feel that. And that was one of the things that really brought us closer together. I think I've mentioned a few times that I always wanted to be able to sing and play an instrument. There was only one problem, I didn't have the talent to sing or play an instrument. So, I get to sit next to someone now who does. You know, children of God, when I started working on the message for this week, it was actually, I think, Thursday night, that I started on this. And it was really in response to a situation that came up. And it became really important to me to get this out for people. And Rose didn't know what I was writing about. I hadn't talked to her about it. I just started doing it. And her song really ties in with where we're going with this. And this was God's doing. It wasn't ours. It wasn't anything that was set up. It was just that this is where we're at tonight. You see, something that is really important to all of us, and it is especially important to those who are in the middle of the situation. Okay, so let me begin at the beginning, and let's talk about where we're given the order of how things are supposed to be. Exodus chapter 20, verses 1 through 7. Then God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who has brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other gods before or besides me. You shall not make yourself any graven images to worship it, or any likeness of anything that is in the heavens above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the waters under the earth. You shall not bow down yourself to them or serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing mercy and steadfast love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not use or repeat the name of the Lord your God in vain, that is lightly or frivolously, in false affirmations or profanely. For the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Okay. Children of God, from the very beginning, God, Yahweh Elohim, is to be number one. He told that to Israel when he brought them out of slavery, and nothing, that is, no thing, should be lifted up in our lives as a challenge to him. But it's easy to wander off, isn't it? It's easy to let things, possessions, position, even in our churches, positions, come to mean more than our relationship with Jesus Christ. Nothing gets in the way of God's love for us, so there should be nothing that gets in the way of our love for him, or our honor of him. But is that the case? Is that what happens? And it surely wasn't what happened with Israel. Here we are, about to enter the promised land.
and what happens. Numbers chapter 14, verses 12 through 22. I will strike them down with a plague and destroy them, but I will make you into a nation greater and stronger than they. But Moses said to the Lord, the Egyptians will hear about it. By your power you brought these people up from among them, and they will tell the inhabitants of the land about it. They have already heard that you, Lord, are with these people, and that you, Lord, have been seen face to face, that your cloud stays over them, and that you go before them in a pillar of cloud by day, and in a pillar of fire by night. If you put all these people to death, leaving none alive, the nations who have heard this report about you will say, the Lord was not able to bring these people into the land he promised them on oath, so he slaughtered them in the wilderness. Now, may the Lord's strength be displayed, just as you have declared. The Lord is slow to anger, abounding in love, and forgiving sin and rebellion. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes the children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generations. In accordance with your great love, forgive the sin of these people, just as you have pardoned them from the time they left Egypt until now. The Lord replied, I have forgiven them as you asked. This whole interchange came because God was ready to wipe out the children of Israel, because they refused to follow him, they refused to do what he told them to do, they refused to go in and take over the land. Moses was pleading for them. God offered to make Moses himself into a great nation. He made Abraham into a great nation. He made Abraham the father of many nations. He offered to make Moses into a great nation. Moses said, no, don't destroy your people. See what the other nations are going to say if you do. Moses was pleading for them, and God forgave them. But take a look at what got taken away from them. In Numbers chapter 14, verses 21 to 31. Nevertheless, as surely as I live, and as surely as the glory of the Lord fills the whole earth, not one of those who saw my glory and the signs I performed in Egypt and in the wilderness, but who disobeyed me and tested me 10 times, not one of them will ever see the land I promised on oath to their ancestors. No one who has treated me with contempt will ever see it. But because my servant Caleb had a different spirit and followed me wholeheartedly, I will bring him into the land he went to, and his descendants will inherit it. Since the Amalekites and the Canaanites are living in the valleys, turn back tomorrow and set out for the desert along the route to the Red Sea. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron, how long will this wicked community grumble against me? I have heard the complaints of these grumbling Israelites, so tell them, as surely as I live, declares the Lord, I will do to you the very thing I heard you say. In this wilderness, your bodies will fall. Every one of you, 20 years old or more, who was counted in the census, who has grumbled against me, not one of you will enter the land I swore with uplifted hand to make your home, except Caleb, son of Jephunneh, and Joshua, son of Nun. As for your children that you said would be taken as plunder, I will bring them in to enjoy the land you have rejected. Children of God, here's the point. Their rebellion against God cost them. They refused to follow him and obey his commands. They refused to listen to his word. And where did they end up? Dead in the wilderness. But they tried to go back in and do it on their own, in their own strength, and they got their backsides kicked. It is only through obedience to God and through honoring his word that there is victory. You know this. The blessings were there. The promised land was right there waiting for them to go in and take over. But they rebelled against God. They rebelled against his word. And they rebelled against his command to them. And that was the result. God gives us instructions. And most of the instructions that God gives us are found in His Word. Now we are living in the new covenant. We are no longer under the law. It is now relationship. Our relationship with Jesus Christ. But some things have not changed. And one of the main things that has not changed, and that is that God is still number one. Jesus is God. And therefore, our relationship with Him must be number one. John chapter 5, verses 20 to 25. For the Father loves the Son, and shows Him all He does. Yes, and He will show Him even greater works than these, so that you will be amazed. For just as the Father raises the dead to give them life, even so the Son gives life to whom He is pleased to give it. Moreover, the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son, that all may honor the Son, just as they honor the Father. Whoever does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent Him. Very truly, I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes Him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but has crossed over from death to life. Very truly, I tell you, a time is coming and has now come when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. Honor the Son, just as you honor the Father. But we, as people, keep messing things up. Instead of using things and loving people, we love things and use people. Instead of honoring God and putting Him first in our lives, we try to use God to bless our lives, while we ignore what He has told us to do and walk in our own ways. And get a clue, children of God. We're not the first to do this. We're not the first to suffer for doing it. And we're not the first to cost ourselves and our own lives for having done it. Isaiah chapter 1, verses 1 through 8. Division, seen by spiritual perception of Isaiah, son of Amos, which he saw concerning Judah, the kingdom, and Jerusalem, its capital, in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah. Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord has spoken. I have nourished and brought up sons, and have made them great and exalted, but they have rebelled against me and broken away from me. The ox instinctively knows its owner, and the donkey its master's crib. But Israel does not know or recognize me as Lord. My people do not consider or understand. A sinful nation, a people loaded with iniquity, offspring of evildoers, sons who deal corruptly, they have forsaken the Lord. They have despised and shown contempt and provoked the Holy One of Israel to anger. They will become utterly estranged, alienated. Why should you be stricken and punished anymore, since it brings no correction? You will revolt more and more. The whole head is sick, and the whole heart is weak, feeble, sick, and nauseated. From the sole of the foot, even to the head, there is no soundness or health in the nation's body. But wounds and bruises and flesh and bleeding stripes, they have not been pressed out and closed up or bound up or softened with oil. No one has troubled to seek a remedy. Because of your detestable disobedience, your country lies desolate. Your cities are burned with fire. Your land, strangers devoured in your very presence, and it is desolate, overthrown by aliens. And the daughter of Zion, Jerusalem, is left like a deserted booth in a vineyard, like a lodge in a garden of cucumbers, like a besieged city spared, but in the midst of desolation. Dear children of God, we live in the United States, a country that was founded on Christian principles, a country that was formed for religious freedoms, that is the United States today, a Christian nation, I would have to say no. We have left, we have gone away. But as people, we are not responsible for what the government has done or said. Okay. We, as people, as children of God, we do not have that power and authority. But no government, we have all the authority. What we can do is to keep in our own lives the honor, love, and focus where it needs to be. We need to concentrate our focus, our efforts into ourselves, into changing us, because we are the only persons that we have control over. We are the only ones that we have the authority to do something about. Okay? We yield ourselves to God. We encourage others, we talk to others, we speak.
We show, but we cannot force, we do not control. Jesus himself never forced anyone to follow him. We cannot bring them to him unwillingly. The Crusades were a great example of people mistaking the call of God in their lives, because people do not come to Christ through force. People do not come to God because they have to. They come to God because they see their need and reach out to Him.
One lifted the hand of God Almighty to part the waters in the sea, but it only took one little light to separate you and me. Oh, we are not as strong as we think we are. And this ain't what he did, Joshua. He made the sun stand still in the sky. But I can't even keep these thoughts of you from passing by. Oh, we are not as strong as what we are. Choking on the fumes of selfish rage, and with these our hells and our heavens so few inches apart, we must be awfully small and not as strong as we think we are. And the man said that they were gonna make the mountains move, and we are trembled like a hill on a fall by just the thought of how I lost you. Oh, we are not as strong as we think we are. We are frail, we are fearfully and wonderfully made, forged in the fires of human passion, choking on the fumes of selfish rage. These are our hells and our heavens, so few inches apart. We must be awfully small and not as strong as we think we are. The waters in the sea, but it only took one little light to separate you and me. Oh, we are not as strong as we think we are.
stand and it takes some grace, so we are not as strong as we think we are. No, we are not as strong.
Ezekiel chapter 18, verses 1 through 26. The word of the Lord came to me. What do you people mean by quoting this proverb about the land of Israel? The parents eat sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge. As surely as I live, declares the sovereign Lord, you will no longer quote this proverb in Israel, for everyone belongs to me, the parent, as well as the child. Both alike belong to me. The one who sins is the one who will die. Suppose there is a righteous man. He does what is just and right. He does not eat at the mountain shrines or look to the idols of Israel. He does not defile his neighbor's wife or have sexual relations with a woman during her period. He does not oppress anyone, but returns what he took in pledge for a loan. He does not commit robbery, but gives food to the hungry and provides clothing for the naked. He does not lend to them at interest or take a profit from them. He withholds his hand from doing wrong. He judges fairly between two parties. He follows my decrees and faithfully keeps my laws. That man is righteous. He will surely live, declares the sovereign Lord. Suppose he has a violent son who sheds blood or does any of these other things, though the father has done none of them. He eats at the mountain shrines. He defiles his neighbor's wife. He oppresses the poor and needy. He commits robbery. He does not return what he took in pledge. He looks to the idols. He does detestable things. He lends at interest and takes a profit. Will such a man live? He will not, because he has done all these detestable things. He is to be put to death. His blood will be on his own head. But suppose this man has a son who sees all the sins his father commits, and though he sees them, he does not do such things. He does not eat at the mountain shrines or look to the idols of Israel. He does not defile his neighbor's wife. He does not oppress anyone or require a pledge for a loan. He does not commit robbery, but gives his food to the hungry. He provides clothing for the naked. He withholds his hand from mistreating the poor. He takes no interest or profit from them. He keeps my laws and follows my decrees. He will not die for his father's sin. He will surely live, but his father will die for his own sin, because he practiced extortion, robbed his brother, and did what was wrong among the people. Yet you ask, why does the son not share the guilt of his father? Since the son has done what is just and right and has been careful to keep all my decrees, he will surely live. The one who sins is the one who will die. The child will not share the guilt of the parent, nor will the parent share the guilt of the child. The righteousness of the righteous will be credited to them, and the wickedness of the wicked will be charged against them. But if a wicked person turns away from all the sins they have committed, and keeps all of my decrees, and does what is just and right, that person will surely live. They will not die, None of the offenses they have committed will be remembered against them. Because of the righteous things they have done, they will live. Do I take any pleasure in the death of the wicked? Declares the Sovereign Lord. Rather, am I not pleased when they turn from their ways and live? But if a righteous person turns from their righteousness and commits sin and does the same detestable things the wicked person does, will they live? None of the righteous things that person has done will be remembered because of the unfaithfulness they are guilty of, and because of the sins they have committed, they will die. Yet you say, the way of the Lord is not just. Hear, you Israelites, is my way unjust? Is not your ways that are unjust? If a righteous person turns from their righteousness and commits sin, they will die for it, because the sin they have committed, they will die. Children of God, if we look at 1 John, it says, and this is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he commanded us. We are still responsible and accountable to our God for our lives. We cannot expect to be blessed to the heavens when we are living like hell. God is still a jealous God. That has not changed. Matthew chapter 10, verses 37 and 38. Anyone who loves their father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves their son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever does not take up their cross and follow me is not worthy of me. He comes first, and he makes no compromises. He is either first in our lives, and that is first up there. Nothing equal, nothing coming close, nothing above. He is either first in our lives, or he is not. John chapter 15, verses 1 through 11. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, but every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me, and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this, so that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be complete. Here is where our blessings are. Our blessings are in and through Jesus Christ. They are in and through our relationship with him. But we cut ourselves off from them because we keep elevating other things and other people in our lives. God is not trying to keep us from those things. He is not trying to put a wall up between us and the things that we need and want in our lives. He just wants to make sure that we've got it right, and to have it right means that he comes first. No matter how great the blessing he gives us, that blessing does not become equal to him. That blessing does not get put in the way of him in our lives. That is the point of this whole message, children of God. We cut ourselves off from His blessings, because we do not realize He is our chief blessing. He is first. He is our Lord and our God. He is the one who loves and cares for us.
Amen.
We need to get that right if we are going to serve, follow Him, if we are going to walk with Him, and if we are going to expect His provision for us, we must have Him first in our lives. There can be no compromise. There can be nothing else in the way.
Daddy was no preacher, but he was righteous to the bone. He could quote the Bible, chapter and verse, in his deep, rich baritone. Daddy always joked the reason Jesus walked on water was to get a better view of how many fish he could have caught there. Daddy said all you needed was the good book and a good hook in a lazy summer day. If you had the good book and a good hook, you'd find heaven either way. And had three kids of my own, but I caught that every Sunday just to hear that baritone. And we talk about the kids, and we talk about the good Lord, and we talk about fishing and His new Mercury outboard. Daddy said all you needed was the good book and a good hook in a lazy summer day. 'Cause if you had a good book and a good hook, you'd find heaven either way. Mama called the sea, choking back the tears to say, "Son, I'm sorry, but Jesus took your daddy home today." She said it was the darndest thing. They found him down by the lake with a trophy trout next to his Bible and a big smile on his face. I smiled and pictured Daddy out there walking on the water and talking with Jesus about how many fish they could have caught there. Daddy said all you needed was a good book and a good hook and a lazy summer day. If you had a good book and a good hook, you'd find heaven either way. A good book and a good hook and a lazy summer day. If you had a good book and a good hook, you'd find heaven either way.
Amen. Matthew chapter 6, verses 24 to 34. No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will stand by and be devoted to the one and despise and be against the other. You cannot serve God and mammon, deceitful riches, money, possessions, or whatever else is trusted in. Therefore, I tell you, stop being perpetually uneasy, anxious, and worried about your life, what you shall eat or what you shall drink, or about your body, what you shall put on. Is not life greater in quality than food, and the body far above and more excellent than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father keeps feeding them. Are you not worth much more than they? And who of you, by worrying and being anxious, can add one unit of measure, one cubit to his stature
or the span of his life? And why should you be anxious about clothes? Consider the lilies of the field and learn thoroughly how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his magnificence, excellence, dignity, and grace was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and green, and tomorrow is tossed into the furnace, will he not much more surely clothe you? Oh, you of little faith. Therefore, do not worry and be anxious, saying, what are we going to have to eat, or what are we going to have to drink, or what are we going to have to wear? For the Gentiles, the heathen, wish for and crave and diligently seek all these things. And your heavenly Father knows well that you need them all. But seek, aim, keep our focus on the kingdom of heaven. Strive for his kingdom and his righteousness, his way of doing and being right. Then all these things taken together will be given to you besides. So do not worry or be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will have trouble and anxieties of its own. Sufficient for each day is its own trouble. God has your back. You put God first, he will take care of everything else. You honor him. You give him your heart and what goes with it. You worship him. You do not put anything close to him. You do not put anything in the way of your relationship with him, and he will take care of the rest of it. It is on him. It is his word at stake, and his word in over 2,000 years has never been proved wrong. There was a sign that I saw, or something that I read, I can't remember where, but it was one of the most pointed things I've ever read. No one who went to Jesus left disappointed. I say that again. No one who went to Jesus left disappointed. Okay. You go to Jesus. You will not leave disappointed. You put your trust, your faith, your heart in him. You put him first in your lives. You will not be disappointed. Okay. It's not going to be a cakewalk. It's not going to be gliding through life. But you will not be disappointed when you walk with him. He knows the way. Put him first. People wonder where their blessings are. People wonder what's happening, why God isn't reaching out to them, why God isn't pouring things down on him. They see it happening here, they see it happening there, but they don't see it happening to them. There are many reasons why that could be happening. One of them could be, it's not time yet. God's still working on something. God has a different plan. But one big reason is because we're not putting him first. We're not putting him where he is supposed to be. We're not putting him where he needs to be. He needs to be this in our lives because that's who he is. We need to acknowledge who he is and put him on the throne and give our glory, honor, praise, and worship to him, not to anyone else, because he is not going to share it. That is not part of his makeup. He is a jealous God. Our relationship with Jesus Christ has to come before any other relationship. That's the way it is. That's the way we walk through this life. We walk with him. And we walk one day at a time. And you know, God had to teach one day at a time to the children of Israel. He had to teach them how to do it. Exodus 16, verses 4 through 6. Then the Lord said to Moses, I will rain down bread from heaven for you. The people are to go out each day and gather enough for that day. In this way I will test them and see whether they will follow my instructions. On the sixth day, they are to prepare what they bring in, and that is to be twice as much as they gather on the other days. So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, in the evening you will know that it was the Lord who brought you out of Egypt. Okay, here it is. We need to keep our focus on God, and our relationship with Jesus needs to come before anything or anyone else. It's easy to say. It's not so easy to do. But it is important to understand and to follow. Putting anything ahead of God jeopardizes whatever we are putting there. It jeopardizes us. It jeopardizes our success. Look at Revelation chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. To the angel, messenger of the assembly, the church at Ephesus, write, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars, which are the messengers of the seven churches, in his right hand, who goes about among the seven golden lampstands, which are the seven churches. I know your industry and activities, laborious toil and trouble, and your patient endurance, and how you cannot tolerate wicked men, and have tested and critically appraised those who call themselves apostles, special messengers of Christ, and yet are not, and have found them to be impostors and liars. I know that you are enduring patiently and bearing up for my name's sake, and you have not fainted or become exhausted or grown weary. But I have this one charge to make against you, that you have left, abandoned, the love that you had at first. You have deserted me, your first love. Remember then from what heights you have fallen. Repent, change the inner man to meet God's will, and do the works you did previously when you first knew the Lord. Or else I will visit you and remove your lampstand from its place unless you change your mind and repent. You see, children of God, we block our blessings, and we render ourselves less effective for the kingdom of God by not following God's instructions to keep him first. The bottom line is, we love him because he first loved us in the first place. Now here is something that we need to be careful about and understand. God knows your hearts. And he knows if you are truly seeking after him or if you're just looking for a formula to try to get through life. Matthew chapter 15, verses 4 through 9. For God said, honor your father and mother, and anyone who curses their father or mother is to be put to death. But you say, if anyone declares that what might have been used to help their father or mother is devoted to God, they are not to honor their father or mother with it. Thus you nullify the word of God for the sake of your tradition. Hypocrites! Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you. These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are merely human rules. Now hear this, children of God. I'm not pointing any fingers at any church. I'm not pointing any fingers at any denomination. I'm not pointing any fingers at any religious organization. But I want you to hear what I'm saying. You are not responsible for the wrong teaching that is going on. But you are accountable to spend your time in God's Word, developing your relationship with Him, coming to know Him through His Word. If you are sitting under false teaching, it is your responsibility to move. And here's something. It's really simple. It's not complicated. You don't need an accountant, a CPA, or a psychic to get this one. Proverbs chapter 3, verses 9 through 10. Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine. Children of God, it is very simple. We're not talking seed faith. We're not talking sow into my ministry and God will bless you 100 times over. No. You give from your heart with a positive attitude to God. You're not giving to the ministry. You're giving to God for his kingdom, for his work in his kingdom. And when you are giving, children of God, the place to give is in your local church, the place where you sit in a congregation with fellow believers, so that that house will be taken care of, okay? The money goes to God, okay? You're not giving it to the pastor. You're not giving it to the elders. You're not giving it to the ministry. Your tithe is going to God. Give it to Him, okay? Hebrews chapter 11, verses 5 through 7. By faith, Enoch was taken from this life, so he did not experience death. He could not be found because God had taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who earnestly seek Him. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not seen, in holy fear built an ark to save his family. By his faith, he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness that is in keeping with faith. Okay. We need to have faith in God. We need to have faith in Jesus Christ. That's it. Faith in the Holy Spirit? Okay, I'll go there. We don't need to have faith in our faith. We don't need to have faith in a televangelist. We don't need to have faith in any pastor or preacher, including me. The only person you need to have faith in is the person of Jesus Christ. That's where our faith needs to be, is in Him.
Hallelujah.
And
hallelujah.
Again and again and again, children of God, it is those who seek Him. In, right there in Hebrews 11, verse 6, those who seek Him, not those who are seeking the reward. Malachi chapter 3, verses 7 through 12. Ever since the time of your ancestors, you have turned away from my decrees and have not kept them. Return to me, and I will return to you, says the Lord Almighty. But you ask, how are we to return? Will a mere mortal rob God? Yet you rob me. But you ask, how are we robbing you? In tithes and offerings, you are under a curse, your whole nation, because you are robbing me. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be enough room to store it. I will prevent pests from devouring your crops, and the vines in your field will not drop their fruit before it is ripe, says the Lord Almighty. Then all the nations will call you blessed, for yours will be a delightful land, says the Lord Almighty. And children of God, why would I bring this up? Why would I bring this up? You see, we're dealing with our hearts, dealing with our relationship with God, and we need to put Him first. And one of the hardest things to do, one of the easiest ways that we go off from God and from honoring Him, is in giving. You know, us, me, I put myself in here as much as anyone else. When we're dealing with our hearts, and our heart is in a right relationship with God, putting Him first, walking with Him, not letting anything or anyone else get in between our relationship with Jesus Christ. And one way to see if we are truly honoring God is if we are following His commands. And here is one of them. The first fruits, the tithe. If you can give more, great. If you have a special reason to give an offering, that's fine. But the tithe is God's. That was from even before the law. It exists after the law. The tithe goes to God. Okay, that's it. Honor Him. He tells you to test Him, to prove Him, to give Him the whole tithe. Okay? He's putting Himself out there. Alright? But I tell you what, no matter how much you give from your wallet, if you do not give from your heart, nothing that comes from your pocket matters. God cares more about your heart, infinitely more about where your heart is than what's in your wallet. If you go into church and you say, well, I'm going to tithe just because I want God to give me more money. Okay, is that honoring God? Is that? Okay, honor God with the first fruits. Honor Him. Put Him first. You can't honor Him if you aren't putting Him first. Matthew chapter 6, verses 19 and 21. Do not gather and heap up and store up for yourselves treasure on earth, where moth and rust and worm consume and destroy, and where thieves break through and steal. But gather and heap up and store for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust nor worm consume and destroy, and where thieves do not break through and steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. That's it. It is your heart that He is interested in. Is our treasure with God, or is it in something else? Now again, children of God, I'm not in any way indicating that you should take your whole paycheck and drop it in the collection plate. I'm encouraging you to honor God, to put Him first, even when it comes to your money. And remember that there are things that are much more important to God. Hear this. Matthew chapter 23, verses 23 to 28. Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You give a tenth of your spices, mint, dill, and cumin, but you have neglected the more important matters of the law: justice, mercy, and faithfulness. You should have practiced the latter. You should have given your tithes without neglecting the former: justice, mercy, and faithfulness. You blind guides, you strain out a gnat and swallow a camel. Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You clean the outside of the cup and dish, but inside they are full of greed and self-indulgence. Blind Pharisee! First clean the inside of the cup and dish, and then the outside will be cleaned. Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You are like whitewashed tombs, which look beautiful on the outside, but inside are full of the bones of the dead and everything unclean. In the same way, on the outside you appear to people as righteous, but on the inside you are full of hypocrisy and wickedness. Justice, mercy, and faith. Honor God, keeping the inside where our hearts are clean, even if the outside looks a little ragged sometimes. Putting God first, making our relationship with Jesus Christ our priority, spending time with Him in prayer and listening and watching for His answers, spending our time in His Word, not just reading, but allowing His Word to fill our hearts and to change us from the inside out. Walking with Him, honoring and worshiping and following Him. Why? To receive a blessing? No, because walking with Him is a blessing. Children of God, Jesus said in Luke chapter 9, verses 23 to 26, then He said to them all, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves, take up their cross daily, and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. Whoever loses their life for me will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world and yet lose or forfeit their very self? Whoever is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when He comes in His glory and the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. Children of God, know this, that this is true, that you, I hope, will get a hold of this, because God loves you, and God wants you back.